When I was a child, farming, or back in the early 2000s, farming was a relatively simple affair. Tractors plowed the field, seeds were sown by hand or with simple machines, and crops were harvested with sweat and hard work. But as I grew older, I saw the landscape of farming change. Machines became much more prevalent, each one designed to make the work of farming easier and more efficient. Though, as the machines became more advanced, so too did the challenges we faced. Climate change, population growth, and food security became pressing issues. Traditional farming methods, which had served us well for centuries, were now contributing to these problems. Soil degradation, water pollution, and greenhouse gas emissions have become the unintended consequences of our efforts to feed a growing population. So, if that's the case, then how do we navigate from our current situation? One that is plagued by high pesticide application, excessive freshwater use, and seasonal growth periods, to a future that is much more sustainable, efficient, and productive. If you've been following agricultural trends for the last couple of years, one idea may immediately come to mind. Vertical farming. If you haven't heard of vertical farming, it is a modern agricultural technique where crops are grown in vertically stacked layers, often in controlled environments like indoor greenhouses or fully sealed facilities. This method aims to increase crop yields, reduce water usage, and eliminate the need for harmful pesticides, making it a promising solution for sustainable agriculture. How many of you have actually seen a vertical farm, either in media or in person? It's quite futuristic, isn't it? Amid all of these challenges, vertical farming emerged as a beacon of innovation, promising a big leap towards sustainability. Tech companies inspired to tackle global food shortages began constructing large-scale vertical farms. These ventures, aiming to revolutionize agriculture with pesticide-free production, quickly captured the imagination of investors. Imagine walking into a supermarket and picking up a pack of fresh strawberries in the dead of winter, grown not thousands of miles away, but right there in your city, in a vertical farm. How many of you would prefer that option? It's a compelling thought, isn't it? So, what happened? At first, it all seemed perfect. Vertical farming companies like Infarm, Bowery Farms, and Aero Farms became instant hits, launching massive futuristic facilities and gathering major investor attention. But after years of operation, they all realized one critical problem. They weren't making any money. Can anyone think about why that might be? You can shout it out if you want. Yes, one of the key deterrents of vertical farming has always been the high energy costs. Maintaining the precise environmental conditions needed for year-round production requires a significant amount of electricity for lighting, climate control, ventilation, and other systems. This, coupled with the high labor costs and excessive, money spent towards the building and the automation stuff, made it really hard for these companies to become profitable. AppHarvest, a prominent vertical farming company, spent over $100 million building a massive 2.76 million square foot facility in Kentucky. However, after years of operation, they struggled to turn a profit and was forced to lay off a significant portion of their workforce. Similarly, Fifth Season, another well-funded vertical farming company, recently announced that it was shutting down its operations, citing the inability to become financially viable. The data paints a stark picture. The average vertical farm spends about 55% of its operating costs on energy, 25% on labor, and only 20% on other expenses. Additionally, the sale of leafy greens, which make up the majority of production of vertical farming, failed to command premium crop prices, further exacerbating this profitability challenge. In other words, they found out that no one's going to pay twice as much for a head of lettuce that was grown on a vertical farm. It just doesn't make sense, especially in this, this climate. So, after analyzing all of these companies, we can begin to classify these failures into three key categories: unsustainable growth models, flawed facility designs, and premature automation. To start, many companies, tackled these flawed business plans, launching giant facilities costing millions of dollars before streamlining operations and, achieving cost efficiency. This premature expansion led to, ballooning costs and financial additional operational challenges that exaggerated all their financial issues. Next, flawed facilities played a key role in the failure of several vertical farms. A lack of focus on proper airflow and ventilation led to massive disease outbreaks that decimated crops, forcing companies to overcompensate with excessive fans and ventilation, which ultimately just made all of these energy costs even higher. Lastly, in their pursuit of cutting-edge technology, many companies pursued very complex automation designs. And this early adoption of these systems not only just drained capital, but made it really difficult to fit all of these into their existing operations by creating new issues and maintenance costs. So luckily, some companies have actually been able to recognize these danger signs and move forward in this industry with more of a strategic and data-driven approach, prioritizing profitability over rapid expansion. Take Oishi, a vertical farming startup in New York. It's a prime example of this. Rather than focusing on building massive facility designs, Oishi has prioritized the production of premium crops like Japanese strawberries and sells them to high-end restaurants and markets for those looking to getting a luxurious treat. By prioritizing profitability and focusing on a niche market, they were able to avoid a lot of the pitfalls that have plagued their larger competitors, all without spending a single dime on leafy greens. The failure of large-scale vertical farming companies offer valuable insights for the future of this industry. It's clear that simply throwing money at the problem and scaling up too quickly is not a sustainable approach. Instead, companies need to make a platform for long-term development and embrace the success of companies like Oishi, who have prioritized profitability over rapid expansion. As we look to the future of agriculture, vertical farming still holds immense potential, especially in Canada, where the long, dark winters pose a significant challenge to traditional farming methods. The successful implementation of vertical farming technologies could be an absolute game changer. But in order to realize these potentials, we must learn from the mistakes of the past and embrace a more sustainable, profitable, and scalable approach to this technology. The key to this relies on a blueprint that I like to call the green loop, an endless cycle that sets forth three key pillars of development: innovation, collaboration, and education. To start, vertical farming companies must continuously innovate and adapt their technologies to increase crop yield, efficiency, and most of all, reduce those energy costs. These may include, you know, examples like optimizing new lighting systems, talking about better ways of maintaining the climate, and ultimately building facilities that are energy efficient, like indoor greenhouses that can sustain year-round production in the cold, harsh climates of things like Canada. Next, collaboration is key because it's no single entity that will be able to carry the future of vertical farming and solve all of these problems. Companies need to work with government agencies, research and academic institutions, companies that exist in other fields, as well as growers themselves, to help build sustainable and productive technologies. Not to mention saving all of the resources needed to work on these technologies. By fostering a collaborative approach, we can accelerate the development and, you know, pace of all of these sustainable and profitable vertical farming companies and deploy them worldwide to make a really big impact on the world. Because after all, it's not just faced in Canada. Food security is a worldwide issue. Lastly, we must focus on education and invest in the next generation of farmers. Companies should work with high schoolers and universities to develop curricula that equip students with the knowledge and expertise needed to thrive in this growing industry. Additionally, we also can't forget about our existing farmers, the ones that are already doing the hard work in the field with those tractors and tools that we saw before. So we need to develop training platforms that not only benefit the new generation, but the old generation, and get them to speed on the latest technology and you know-how. Ultimately, the future for vertical farming is clear, or the path forward, or path upward, I should say, is clear. Focus on profitability, optimize operations, diversify crop selection, and embrace the beauty of the green loop by actively engaging in innovation, collaboration, and education. Ultimately, by learning from the mistakes of the past and embracing a more strategic, data-driven approach, we can cultivate a brand new future for vertical farming, one that nourishes not both our planet, but also future generations of people to come. Thank you.